Hello, you are welcome to Biochemistry for PA and Medical Students. My name is Osei Kojo, and I'm hoping that you are a new student. So we are starting with introduction to biochemistry. Okay, so when you hear the term biochemistry, I don't know what comes into your head, but when I heard it for the first time, I thought maybe it's biology and chemistry combined. Yeah, if that's what you are thinking, then you are not far from right, yeah. Okay, so you're right. Biochemistry is a hybrid science. So it consists of biology and then chemistry also. Okay, so we know that biology is the study of living organisms, and chemistry is the study of chemical atoms and molecules. Okay, so basically, if we are joining these two terms together, biochemistry is the science of atoms and molecules in living organisms. That's it. Yeah. Okay. Or we can also say that it is the science that deals with the study of chemical constituents of living cells and the reaction and processes they undergo. Yeah. Okay. So let us look at the chemical composition of living matter. When we take living matter, what do they contain? Okay. Let's shift our attention to human beings, not just any living organism. Okay, so in the human body, when you look at the human body, it is made up of 25 elements, okay, 25 naturally occurring elements. There are about 92 of them, but only 25 are incorporated into living matter. Okay, when we talk about elements, they are a specific single type of atom that cannot be broken down into simpler forms. Okay, so these 25 elements, okay, that are found in living matter is what we call biogenic elements, okay, because they have the ability to produce life. Okay, bio means life, and genic means ability to produce, or yeah, something like that. Okay, so these biogenic elements form biomolecules. So we talk about biomolecules. These are larger molecules, okay? They are larger biological molecules that deals in the maintenance and then metabolism, okay? So basically, if I have a wound on my hand, okay, and I lose some tissue or some skin, okay, I expect that in a few days' time, the skin should be replaced, okay? So what does this, okay? The skin is made up of proteins and then other biomolecules, okay? So basically, if I lose those, if I lose skin, it means that these biomolecules which form the skin should be able to replace it for me, okay? And these biomolecules, they are breakdown and they are synthesis, okay? Releases energy into the body to be used, yeah. Okay, so the principal types of biological molecules are carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids. We are going to take all these one after the other, yeah, in subsequent lectures. Okay, so when we talk about these biogenic elements, they can be classified into three main classes. These are macrobiogenic, microbiogenic, and then trace elements. When we talk about macrobiogenic elements, these are elements that are found in large quantities, okay, or they make up the majority, okay, of the human weight. Okay, so these include carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. Okay, so let us take some of these macrobiogenic elements and then describe what they do. So when we take carbon, for instance, it is the element on which all life on earth is based on, because all tissues in the body contain carbon compounds. Yeah, so basically, if you take any compound, most of the compounds in the body contains carbon. Okay, so another example of a macrobiogenic element is oxygen and hydrogen also. These are found in organic and inorganic compounds. Okay, so basically, what do? They form the micromolecule water. Water is a micromolecule, okay? It is needed for the survival of living organisms, so, because every living organism depends on water, okay? So nitrogen also is a component of proteins and nucleic acids. We'll be talking about these biomolecules, and then we'll be taking them one after the other. Nitrogen is also known as the chief gas of the atmosphere. Phosphorus helps connect individual units of DNA into a long chain. As I said, if maybe you might not get this these terms, okay, or these contents now, but when we take these biomolecules, you see what these elements do in the biomolecules. Okay, sulfur forms the disulfide bridge between different parts of the proteins. Okay, this helps to keep the 3D structure. A protein or a functional protein has a 3D structure. So these disulfide bridges keep the 3D structure and prevents it from forming straight chains and straight chains. Okay, amino acids is not a functional protein. Okay, they cannot perform any specific function. Okay, so we will basically want to maintain the 3D structure of the protein if we want it to work. Okay. So microbiogenic elements, these are basically catalysts. When we talk about catalysts, they are substances that speed up chemical reactions. Okay, and then examples are sodium, potassium, magnesium, calcium, and chlorine, and they form 3.99%. Okay, the macrobiogenic elements, they form 96% of the human body weight. So you can see how large they are, okay, or how abundant they are in the human body. Okay, so sodium, potassium, and all these elements have other functions too. Okay, sodium and potassium helps in the transport of substances across the cell membrane. Okay, and these trace elements, these are usually inorganic constituents. Okay, they are found in fluids that surround the cell or that bathe the cell, and most of them are they are cofactors. Okay, or they assist catalysts to speed up chemical reactions. Basically, yeah, if they are found bathing the cell or around the cell, and then most chemical reactions occur outside the cell or the cell membrane, and if these elements are there, I think they are in a strategic position to be able to speed up the chemical reactions which occurs at the cell membrane level. Okay, so I said earlier on that only 25 of the 92 elements are incorporated into living matter. You would ask why. Okay, so these are the answers. Some elements are toxic. Example is cadmium, lead, mercury. Okay, these have toxic effect when they are in high quantities in the body. Okay, so the body cannot risk having all these elements in the body. That is why they are not found in the body. And then some elements are also stable. Example are the inert gases: helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, and radon. Okay, you see, elements are constantly reacting or interacting with each other in the body. Okay, so if you are stable and you are not forming any chemical reaction, it means you are basically not important. Okay. Yeah, so that is why these elements are not found in living matter. Okay, and some of these elements are radioactive and or artificial. Okay, some are radioactive and artificial, some are radioactive but natural. Okay, you can't risk having these radioactive elements in the body. That is why they cannot be found in the body. Okay, so this brings us to the end of our introductory lecture. I hope you loved or you like this lecture. Give me a thumbs up and then subscribe to my channel so that you can get updates on my new videos. Okay, thank you very much. I'll put my WhatsApp number in the description below so that if you want the slides, I can forward it to you. If you have any question to anything you want to share, you can do that. Thank you very much.